tonight to have a special guest here at the Historical Society. If you're a fan of film, then you know about the subject of his book, the subjects of his book, and a little bit about their life story. And so we're happy to bring him here to share some of that story with you. So Cáel Keegan is an assistant professor of women, gender, and sexuality studies and liberal studies at Grand Valley State University. So I'm going to read a paragraph.
That's cool.
Cáel views Lana and Lilly Wachowski's films as an approach to trans experience that maps a transgender journey and the promise we might learn to sense beyond the limits of the given world. Keegan reveals how the filmmakers take up the relationship between identity and coding, be it computers or genes, inheritance and belonging, and how transgender becoming connects to a utopian vision of a post-racial order. Along the way, he theorizes a trans aesthetic that explores the plasticity of cinema to create new social worlds, new temporalities, and new sensory inputs and outputs. Film comes to disrupt, rearrange, and evolve the cinematic exchange with the senses in the same manner that trans disrupts, rearranges, and evolves discrete genders and sexes. Mm-hmm. That's great, thank you. Mm-hmm. So with no further ado,
there are some reasons why I wrote this book. First of all, it's not every day that a mainstream Hollywood director comes out as transgender and then it happens again. in fact, I had begun the project after Lana came out and gave her HRC Visibility Awards speech, and then Lily came out and I got like 100 Google alerts in one day. And I was like, what is happening? Oh my gosh, right? So the work has an urgency to it in the sense of trying to make sense of what's happening on the ground in terms of film history and in terms of transgender history. But also there's a kind of activism, archival activism, that tends to happen in trans studies, where as people's identities become kind of revealed to us, we need to do the work of going back into the archive of how their work has been interpreted to actually work on the body of that interpretive archive, right? So one thing I wanted to do was really intervene in the scholarly interpretation and reception of the Wachowskis' work, this kind of record of the work as being incomplete and needing scholarly attention. And particularly because I'm a student of trans culture, I'm also transgender myself, I felt that it was kind of a sort of political intent I was bringing to the project. I also wanted to offer new ideas to the kind of burgeoning field of transgender media studies, that to think more broadly about how transgender media production itself has work to alter our common understandings of embodiment, of the senses, and of our understanding of shared reality itself. I feel that in my larger work, I'm really working on a project about how transgender politics and communities have really been one of the main forces pressing against our shared understanding of reality and under the sort of conditions of postmodernity. And I feel that the Wachowski's work is really central to that project because it has been so widely circulated and so central to how we think about how cinema works as a culture. And lastly, I wanted to think about how cinema itself has a very deep relationship to transgender identities and political movements. From the beginning of sort of the transgender movement in Germany, where Magnus Hirschfeld was screening films in his Institute for Sexual Research, where he was acting in films while also kind of using his own body as a kind of laboratory for synthetic hormones, and thinking about how cinema has played such a huge role in our ability to produce fantasy bodies. And so what is the relationship between cinema as a technology and gender transition as a technology? And this work is kind of a beginning of that project and something I'm thinking about digging further into. In terms of theses for the book, what I'm really arguing is that the Wachowski cinema has invented a popular trans aesthetics. We think of transgender culture as being pushed into the corners of of popular culture itself. Like, you have to dig really, really deep to find examples of trans creative work. But it turns out that's not actually true, and hasn't been true for a long time, because they've been making Hollywood cinema for 2 decades. So I wanted to develop a theory of how their work has changed the look and function of the cinematic body itself through the way that they have intervened on the production processes of cinema. So if we think about the effects design of The Matrix, which I'll talk about later in this talk, that is one way in which cinema production, the very conceptualization of the body in cinema, has been fundamentally altered by the trans imaginary as it works on that medium. But it's not as simple as that, because we also have to think about how cinema has changed how bodily possibilities are imagined in reality as well. So this kind of mutually constitutive relationship between culture and the imagination, where something like, we see that really come to fruition in Sense8, I think, in certain ways. So I'm trying to kind of smash these two texts together to you today, kind of the beginning and end of the current body of the Wachowskis' work, to think about this relationship. More broadly, I'm claiming in the work that their cinema has altered the aesthetics of popular film and television from the perspective of method, not necessarily representation, but the actual production process proceeds from a trans sensibility, and I'll talk a bit more about that later on when we get into these two different pieces of work. And lastly, a historical claim, how appropriate in this space, that really what needs to happen is that their work needs to be reclassified as some of the most important and influential transgender-produced culture in human history. That this is some of the most widely circulated, widely engaged with transgender-produced media ever. And that's unprecedented, even though it happened a while ago. So the temporality of the project is kind of paradoxical. So that's kind of the major claims of the work, more broadly. In terms of developing new methods and theories, what I'm really trying to do is bring this kind of burgeoning field of trans studies to bear on the traditional mode of the auteurist study in cinema studies, which is this idea that, like, the great genius makes this, like, work that reflects their singular vision. And what I'm trying to kind of think about is how our engagement with cinema can actually construct the author far after the fact, right? That the traditional idea of the auteur is the auteur comes first, the work comes second, the work reflects the auteur. But what if the work comes first and the auteur comes second in a process of kind of backwards construction, right? The same way that trans people reverse the relationships between sex and gender. Gender is supposed to follow sex, but what if sex follows gender, right? So a kind of reversal of that process. I'm looking to intervene in the over-determining focus on visibility in trans media studies. There's so much focus on getting positive images, getting appropriate casting, making sure that we have non-stigmatized representations. And that's certainly valuable and necessary, but what else could we do with media beyond look for more realist kinds of representations? So what do you do with work by trans people that, say, for the first 20 years does not contain transgender representation? How do you make sense of that? So what I tried to do in the work was develop a new theory that I call sensing transgender, where we don't look for transgender identity, but we approach the work through the senses, themselves. And in that regard, we can bypass the overdetermining issue of representation that we see kind of locking down the discussion of the value of transgender media. And so I'll talk a bit about The Matrix, a text that trans communities have long been drawn to as something that kind of speaks to our experience, but again, does not contain any kind of like direct representation of trans people and was not made by out trans people at the time. So it's kind of where the project lives. In terms of developing, I want to talk about a bit about history because we're in a historical space. what I wanted to do by writing the book was to establish the Wachowskis as major contributors to the history of LGBTQ cinema itself. I found when I was researching that they have really been written out of that history by the way that that history has been constructed. If you look at how their work is in many ways coming to fruition right around the same time that new queer cinema is on the rise, right? And there are these like different pathways directors were taking up where they could get studio financing or they couldn't because they were out or they were not, right? But they wanted to make art cinema versus studio or genre cinema. That really those conditions have prevented the Wachowskis from being thought of as people who are in dialogue with that movement. Their first film, Bound, features very prominently in the book as a work that's really kind of in conversation with new queer cinema in some important ways. What I'm really arguing when I talk about Bound, which I won't tonight, but people seen it?
Yes.
Thank you. You really should see this if you haven't. It really is kind of the thesis statement of the Wachowskis' entire body of work in a lot of ways. I go back to this film as a film that is really illustrating how trans imaginaries were co-constitutive or co-created with queer politics. And there's a kind of narrative that trans kind of trails after queer. Like, you know, we got the L, we got the G, we got the B, then we get the T, right? This kind of temporality to the community formation that's very much present in readings of trans cinema that come from queer studies scholars. But my argument is that trans is actually an inherent part of, and it's a kind of suppressed part of this record of cinema production. And Bound is one of the best examples of this. And then lastly, and this is where I'm kind of finishing up and working on a new project, is this idea that there is a reciprocal relationship between the evolution of popular media forms and the evolution of transgender identification itself. That different kinds of media forms arise historically and technologically, and those make possible certain modes of imagination, bodily construction, and that this is still an ongoing thing. If you look at how trans communities are engaging with the internet, this is still developing. So I'm kind of curious and interested in pursuing that. So that's kind of like a broad overview, and what I'm going to do is read a bit to you from the introduction of the book, and then we'll talk a bit about The Matrix and Sense8 as kind of case studies of this broader set of ideas. So this is from the introduction, which is called Sensing Transgender. It is the day after the Orlando Pulse massacre, and Lana Wachowski is wearing black. I am as well, but this is purely coincidence. Rushing with the jittery nerves of a young researcher to the Sense8 shoot in Gary, Indiana that June morning, I had not given much thought to the news or to the color of my t-shirt. When Wachowski arrives to begin the day's work, I see immediately that she has. Her black shirt is emblazoned with a pink triangle, accompanied by what I learn are the words, "Who's next?" in Cyrillic. When I inquire about the language, Karen Winslow Wachowski, Lana's wife, explains to me that Lana and her sister Lilly wore these shirts during their press tour for Jupiter Ascending. Knowing they would be screening the film in Russia, the siblings and longtime co-directors used the shirts and matching armbands to protest the anti-gay propaganda law and stated there in 2013. Today, in the wake of the 49 murders at Pulse, Who's Next carries a renewed and terrible resonance. Quietly observing the crew's unfolding preparations, previous day's news slowly catches my heels, and I struggle to make sense of the scene in the face of such disaster for others. As the sun begins to arc high, we throng into a ruined Gothic Revival church, its ceiling caved in by fire. From behind my dust mask and hard hat, I watch Wachowski work for hours with the cast, crew, and co-director James McTeague in beating early summer heat. More than anything that day, I am struck by the remarkably touching nature of her process. She touches everyone, blocking the cast members, physically guiding her Steadicam operator from behind while looking past his shoulder into the camera. She stands side by side with an actor for nearly an hour, asking for a short set of lines, again and again, until the necessary emotion pours out. She even touches me in a brief hug. I notice how simply by wearing the shirt, Wachowski has wordlessly brought the violence of the massacre into the shoot as an acknowledgement and a challenge. These are the stakes of being queer, trans, and of color in America. This is what we are imagining against. In response, the shoot feels full of a fierce sorrow, a desiring strain towards something else. Driving back to Michigan the next day, tears will roll unexpectedly down my face. In a 2012 interview with The Village Voice, Lana Wachowski reflects, "Growing up, fantasy was the world as the world would never be, and science fiction was the world filled with problems and ideas as it could be. We were always more drawn to science fiction than to fantasy, but for Lily and me, science fiction has always been an experimental genre." At the very bottom of the same interview, she touches again on this utopian theme, saying, "I believe inherent in any artist's work is an optimistic truth, that the very creation of art is in itself an act of optimism." Across these statements, Wachowski expressed a faith in the subjunctive quality of art to lead us elsewhere. If by art we come to sense differently, we might then arrive at another world. This is the thesis and animating philosophy behind all of the Wachowski cinema. It is also a conviction uniquely attuned with transgender experience. Transgender phenomenology roots in the desire to make perceivable a feeling of gender that others have not yet witnessed. In his enthralling exploration of transsexual self-narration, Second Skins, Jay Prosser grounds transgender subjectivity in a felt imaginary that seeks to recover what was not. Sensing something others miss, the trans imaginary summons its own literalization, its externalization, its substantiation, immaterial flesh. We could say that trans describes an inherently subjective relation to what is considered real, to what can be commonly sensed. To survive, transgender people have had to craft imaginaries that sustain our desire to become, our belief that we might come into perception differently, the world and me as we could be. Transgender studies grows out of the same desiring resistance to dictated form. In her foundational 1992 essay, The Empire Strikes Back, a post-transsexual manifesto, Sandy Stone called for a new transgender movement that would cast off the linear medical model imposed on transsexual identity, reconstituting trans not as a gender, but rather as a genre, quote, whose potential for productive disruption of structured sexualities and spectra of desire has yet to be explored, unquote. An entire field concatenated in the quarter century following Stone's call, shifting the focus of inquiry from transgender objects to trans as an analytic for linking the questions of space and movement to other critical crossings of categorical territories. Today, transgender studies describes trans not as an identification, but as a force characterized by unpredictable flows across discrete forms, a paratactic that enacts the prepositional with, through, of, in, and across, animating vitality itself. Like science fiction, trans is about how what could happen haunts the present, asking us to consider where in elements in reality might lead if permitted to reach. The sticky fingers of the fronded asterisk in trans are the speculative lines of transgender's felt imaginary, sensing outward with faith to realize new contacts. Trans thus marks the capacity to transform one reality into another, how transgender phenomenology necessitates a ceaseless navigation between the tangible and intangible, sense and perception, imagination and reality. Toward what might a trans cinema reach? Cinema, of course, is a technology that orders our senses. Cinema filters our prediscursive affects so they might become collectively, cognitively grasped. Much like gender, cinematic technology thoroughly permeates our idea of the real, such that we cannot access the world except through its language. Cinematic schemas arrange our shared expectations of what might happen at any moment, our common sense. A popular trans cinema would thus have speculative designs on shared reality. We could envision such a cinema as a desiring confrontation with what might be commonly perceived, a sensing at the far edges of pre-existing cinematic forms arising from within a trans imaginary. Such a popular cinema would appear to not yet exist. Operating within the marginalized realm of independent queer and LGBT cinema, trans-authored films have rarely received widespread distribution, viewership, or critical attention. or so we might presume. When Lana and Lilly Wachowski came out as transgender women, they retroactively altered the history of transgender cultural production. Disclosing how trans-authored work is already located at the very center of our cultural imaginary. There is little theoretical context for such a revelation. Until recently, studies of transgender and cinema have largely been of transgender in cinema, the literature overdetermined by a focus on representation, casting, and performance. To make sense of Wachowski's work as popular cinema produced by transgender creators requires alternative practices, through which we might revisit objects to tell new stories about things many of us thought we already knew. Such revisitations are an inherent part of trans meaning making, crucial to how trans lives demand recognition in new genders and sexes that are not new, how trans people make ourselves perceivable in reverse. Lilly Wachowski invites such a return when she states, quote, "There's a critical eye being cast back on Lana's and my work through the lens of our transness, and this is a cool thing, because it's an excellent reminder that art is never static," unquote. To read trans in the Wachowski cinema would therefore be to meet transgender as it is practiced, deploying the heuristics by which trans subjects bring what has only been sensed into shared recognition. Below, I argue that the Wachowski cinema establishes a common cinematic language for sensing beyond gender's dictated forms, and therefore the real, that can be periodized to the end of the 21st century. Mutually constitutive with the historical formation of transgender as a form and a politics, their cinema can be understood as an aesthetic record of how mass cultural forms are interlaced with the genealogy of transcultural production. I thus employ the asterisk in trans theoretically to denote the potential of this convergence where cinema, theory, history, politics, and autoethnography collide to concatenate a trans imaginary of the senses that has appeared unnoticed at the heart of our cinematic reality. Oriented by the same desire and tense that drives the Wachowski cinematic vision, I seek to turn trans studies toward the sensorial field as activated by film theory, leaping this limit to produce a cross-pollinating discussion of the directors as inventors of a popular trans cinema. In what follows, I trace how their work has established trans as a millennial and speculative mode for imagining against and beyond dominant representations of gender, race, space, and time, discussing how their films invent a trans aesthetic that strains against the colonial foundations of modernity. The asterisk in my work marks this subjunctive roving across and through vitality I follow in their cinema, leaping from affects toward new perceptions. To sense transgender is thus both call and response, a delayed yet faithful exchange that relates how over their two decades of filmmaking, the Wachowskis have offered us a trans cinematic engagement with the world. An aesthetic, a method, and an intervention sensing transgender names how the Wachowski cinema animates trans as a sensing beyond the representational edges of popular media forms. Their work offers a sustained confrontation with the sensorial borders that demarcate cinematic reality, illustrating how involuntary forms of common sense fix the perceptible field. The aesthetic I seek to describe therefore treats cinema as if it was gender itself, disrupting, rearranging, and evolving the cinematic sensorium in the same manner that trans disrupts, rearranges, and evolves discrete genders and sexes. Sensing transgender does not search the Wachowski cinema for transgender identity alone, but instead reads trans in its moments of speculative expansion, where it confronts what makes sense. And this is from a section of the book on the Matrix called Ecstatic Passages. 20 years later, what new is there that can be said about the Matrix? I mean, really. Critically revisiting a film with such a deep and rich literature and such a broad cultural impact seems almost like a paradoxical proposition. There is so much to cover that ironically there is nothing that seems most immediately pressing to investigate. And yet clearly, given all the retrospectives going on right now, it's about to hit its 20th anniversary on March 31st, there is something about The Matrix that still captures the popular imagination, even as so many of its once sensational ideas have become the stuff of our everyday lives. So my approach to this text today, discussing it with you, is to play a kind of a trick by revealing new meaning from within an object we think we already know. How many people have seen this film?
Huh. What are you talking about?
A few people did not raise their hands. Do not shame them. I'm going to propose briefly to you why and how this film still contains surprises and what new meaning we might make from it. For those of you who haven't seen it, trust me, you've already seen it. I'll talk about that. Today, we know that The Matrix's critical success and unfolding virality across global popular culture has fundamentally impacted the common themes, looks, and techniques of mainstream film and television. Even if we have not seen it, we have still witnessed its impacts on media production and aesthetics. Digital imaging innovations developed for The Matrix franchise, including bullet time and virtual camera, have subsequently become industrialized by Hollywood, permanently altering cinematic representations of time, space, and embodiment. Film studies scholarship continues to revisit The Matrix to extend already rich discussions of its craftsmanship and its depiction of race. But the film has also been widely analyzed for its exploration of postmodernity, its religious undertones, its transmedia platforming across movies, video games, and comics, and its representation of the virtual realities associated with the rise of internet culture. Multiple studies situate The Matrix as a threshold text, as a film that visually defined the advent of the 21st century, introducing a new multicultural utopianism, and illustrating the approaching convergence of film production with video gaming and the internet with daily life. Now, I show The Matrix in my classes, and often my students haven't seen it. There was like a moment where all of a sudden they hadn't seen it. I got older, they stayed the same age. And I've often thought that one of the reasons why many younger people have not seen this film is because we are now living inside many of the effects that, at the time it was released in 1999, the film helped us to anticipate. It's like not a total shock that we now all live in The Matrix. Like, it happened. Sometimes the most visionary science fiction becomes nonfiction, and through its own prescience, loses its speculative charge. However, what we didn't know in 1999 that we know now is that the film is the first example of a blockbuster cinematic work by transgender writers and directors, the Wachowski sisters, who have since its release become the world's most influential transgender media producers. Mm-hmm. Given this recent destabilization of who we have assumed The Matrix's creators are, I want to invite you to think about this film through two new lenses tonight, which together restage some of the major tensions and contradictions internal to it in new ways. The first lens I'll suggest is the lens of identity, through which we might consider The Matrix as a text authored by transgender creators, a film that appears at the precise historical moment when transgender identity politics were emerging into mainstream North American discourse. For example, looking back, we notice now how The Matrix was released the same year as Boys Don't Cry, which electrified audiences with its depiction of the life and death, early death of transgender youth Brandon Tina. Considering The Matrix alongside Boys Don't Cry, as well as other contemporaneous films, such as All About My Mother and Being John Malkovich, provides a fascinating example of how ideas about transgender identities were influencing the center of the millennial cultural imaginary. Through the lens of a transgender identity politics, it becomes important to claim The Matrix as the most significant cultural text yet created by transgender people. While identity has always been an important theme in The Matrix, naming the text as a film that is at least partially about transgender identification transforms it into another kind of cultural and historical milestone. Naming is, of course, an important issue for transgender people ourselves, a theme narrativized in the film by Agent Smith's repeated misnaming of Neo as Mr. Anderson. And I'll say that, you know, the problem of names and the conundrum, particularly that authorial intent or production produces in the Wachowskis' careers, you know, every time I've been invited to go to lots of screenings of The Matrix, and every time that title card comes up that says the Wachowski brothers, I'm thinking like, really? not quite right, right? So there's a long history of trans communities pointing out how The Matrix's plot actually follows the sequence of dysphoria, identity realization, name change, hormone therapy, surgery, and then social reintegration in a new gender that is today so recognizable as the medically mandated pathway for gender transition. And perhaps the most direct example of this resonance, the film's iconic red pill, blue pill scene between Morpheus, played by Lawrence Fishburne, and Neo, played by Keanu Reeves, replays the scenario of transgender diagnosis. The red pill stands in for the perceptually and physically transformative effects of hormone therapy, while Morpheus performs the clinical role of therapist, analyzing the transgender subject's sense that something is wrong with the world. Dialogue in this scene, what you know, you can't explain, but you feel it, you felt it your entire life. There's something wrong with the world. Captures a trans affect for which language barely exists. Something is wrong with reality. The gendered structure of the world does not seem true, but others live within it as if it were pre-social, coterminous with nature. The world cannot recognize or reflect the sensation, so that the awareness of accepted reality's incompleteness is rendered invisible or irrational. We call this dysphoria. From this seed forward, the matrix will harness the dysphoric sense of reality's wrongness as a cinematic technology, thereby altering what it is possible to perceive. As Neo reaches for the red pill, he is doubled on either side of Morpheus's mirrored sunglasses, marking this divergence between a world that is physically and existentially determined and one that no longer enforces a closed system of physics. The moment is a sensational citation of gender transition and its ecstatic passage into postmodern hyperreality. Neo swallows the red pill, and like Dorothy in Oz or Alice in Wonderland, slips over the edge of the real, where another body waits for him. Sensationally and historically perceivable. But it's never really been the plot of The Matrix that has been its most original or outstanding feature. The Matrix's narrative and diegesis have always been secondary to how the film looks. It is the aesthetics of the film that make everything else about it work, and frankly, it is the aesthetics we remember. So, through a second lens, we might hang on to the question of its transgender identity while paying renewed attention to how this film affects our senses. And that second lens is focused on the film's effects design. Through this lens, we might also consider how The Matrix offers popular audiences not simply a narrative of transgender identification, but a radically new aesthetic that proceeds from a transgender point of perception. The Matrix does indeed follow a story of identity realization, but it simultaneously reorganizes our senses through groundbreaking special effects that alter our perception of time, space, and the body, so that the concept of discrete identities is everywhere challenged and exceeded. Attention to the film's aesthetic design just thus helps us grasp something unique that the Wachowskis have offered to cinema production history, a marriage of speculative narrativity and emblematic aesthetics that teaches audiences about what it might feel like to experience more than one body, to move through time and space outside the established rules for reality, or to sense things that others cannot perceive as real. This aesthetic lens moves us outside the simple proposition of the film being really about transgender identification toward the larger question of what aesthetic worlds a transgender popular cinema might make possible to imagine, as well as the effects of those aesthetics on us and the audience. Through this aesthetic lens, I would invite you to think of The Matrix's effects design not simply as spectacle, but as a sensorial invitation to a set of ideas, one that asks us to sense transgender as a new way of arranging reality itself. Perhaps the most iconic of these effects is the film's phenomenal development of bullet time, an effect called for by name in the Wachowskis' first script for the film that splits time spent moving the camera from time passing in the frame, giving us the sensation of two temporalities at once, an effect resonant with the experience of gender transition and its multiple embodiments across time. Speaking at DePaul University in 2014, the Wachowskis noted of the effect, and this is Lana, quote, "We were trying to find a way to express the delimitation of reality. So we were talking about how every audience member has a relationship to a camera move being related to time and space. So you have to move a camera through space, and it takes a certain amount of time. We talked about, could you put a camera on a rocket? We talked about how do you begin to express the kind of idea we were looking for, of being able to push at the boundaries of reality," unquote. In this comment, Wachowski describes bullet time not merely as an aesthetic effect, but as the visual incitement of a larger premise, an expansion of what is possible for the sensorium and its perceptions under the dictates of formal time and space. So the paradox of The Matrix is this. Is the film an unprecedented example of previously unrecognized transgender authors making a blockbuster transgender hero narrative? Sure. I mean, yeah. Or is it an example of how cinematic expansion of perceived realities that the film achieves might lead to new modes of imagining and expressing one's own embodiment or one's own gender? Like, I speculate in this book about whether watching The Matrix 20, 30, 40 times actually made me transgender. I think it's possible. I really do. And the sense of unlocking certain kinds of possibilities. Did the Wachowskis make a secretly transgender film, or did this film make available new sensations that have led to changes in how we understand the possibilities of the body and of gender? Perhaps, like Neo himself within the film, The Matrix occupies a temporal conundrum in which these are simultaneous and codependent truths, neither more real than the other. These paradoxical formations are as central to the experience of living as a transgender person as they are to the interrelated processes by which our senses organize cinema and cinema organizes our senses. Perhaps the most important moment in this film, then, is the one that offers itself most equally to both these lenses, identity, aesthetics. The moment when its diegesis most overtly signals a transgender identity politics, even as its visual effects seek to explode our sense of the available categories for identity itself. In a looped pattern common to many of the Wachowskis' works, this scene repeats the structure of the film's first sequence. A cursor blinks on a black screen as Neo calls into the machine mainframe, and the same trace code that opens the film, call, trans, opt, received, again suggests the new availability of transgender as an analytic and an identity. The mainframe picks up the call, and Neo delivers his revolutionary message.
I know you're out there. I can feel you now. I know that you're afraid. You're afraid of us. You're afraid of change. I don't know the future.
I'm a 90s kid, okay? So while Neo's manifesto in that scene is delivered from the stance of a revolutionary identity claim, the scene's special effects communicate a sensational pressing beyond the systems that produce identities themselves. As he makes the utopian claim of the speech stating a world where anything is possible, the virtual camera transits through the negative space between the coded layers of the M and F, those highly identifiable markers of medical and legal gender, and into the blackness beyond.
Nice.
Where we go remains an open question. It is not yet clear what the radical changes in technology, embodiment, and gender we have lived through in the two decades since the film's release will deliver. Welcome to the edge of the real. And this is from a section of the book on Sensei. It's from the epilogue called Event Horizon. If V for Vendetta is anachronic, and Cloud Atlas is diachronic, Sensei is synchronic, marking an event horizon at which the Wachowskis' work subsides into an immersive exploration of global simultaneity. Sensei's storyline is constellated through the senses of eight characters spread over the globe who realize that they are not human, but a separate hominid species, Homo sensorium, that lives secretly among humans in psychically linked groups. When a cluster is born, its sensates begin to merge into mutate into merged consciousness, their brains morphologically shifting, and the borders of their bodies falling away. The eighth sense referenced in the series title, which was hosted on Netflix. People have seen this also?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. The eighth sense referenced in that title is the enhanced capacity for empathetic contact that the homo sensoria, or sensates, experience within their cluster. Cluster members can share sensations, memories, affects, skills, and communicate directly across time and space by visiting. A telepathic and telekinetic link, the show demonstrates through an editing process that transposes the sensate's bodies across its globally disparate settings. Over the course of this series, authored and directed by the Wachowskis, the eight main characters must form a unified symbiosis, an eightfold composite character to evade the biologic preservation organization, a eugenicist entity that lobotomizes homo sensoria and uses them as remotely operated weapons. That's just the premise for the show. It's chunky. Although much analysis of Sensei remarks on the strength of its queerness, trans is the necessary keyword in any attempt to understand the series. A media text that provokes a new understanding of the Wachowskis as transgender auteurs, Sensei unites elements from across their oeuvre in a distinctly trans approach to both concept and design. Thematically, the series clearly contains speculative analogies to the oppressive role of medicine in transgender people's lives and the desire for alternative forms of queer and trans kinship. However, the Wachowskis' recent comings out provide an unavoidably reorienting paratext for reading Sensei as an aesthetically trans piece of media. The series probes beneath the descriptive accounts of identity, exploring trans as an intra and inter-subjective experience of entangled sensories, a constant navigation between what is internally sensed and what is externally perceived. While to become sensate is quite literally to gain additional bodies, sensate's characters must also learn to feel across and through the movement between vital forms, race, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, nationality, represented by their various embodiments and situated life worlds. Sensei thus presents an astonishing exploration of trans phenomenology, achieving a unique televisual language that aestheticizes the transsensorium as a narrative form. A utopian response to modernity's concretized orders of experience, Sensei enacts a trans horizon that widens our proprioceptive positions, giving us the sensations of a thickened now and a multiplied here. Resisting realism's totalizing account of the present, Sensei, in the words of José Muñoz, helps us feel a then and there with subjunctive immediacy, as if they were already happening. As in all Wachowski productions, Sensei's emblematic opening sequence teaches us how to engage the text. Designed by Karen Winslow Wachowski, the title credits consist of 108 aerial and street-level shots from every location in the series, capturing a stream of brilliantly colored life and nature and temporal and spatial flow. Set to a tensely pulsing choral and string piece composed by co-director Tom Tickver, The immersive sequence begins in standard speed, then races forward in time lapse, only to smash back into the first location, which happens to be San Francisco, as the music ends in crescendo. Let's take a look. And so to skip the introduction is just a major no-no with them. So this electrifying introduction to Sensate sensitizes us to how the series pleats geography inward, producing a feeling of global simultaneity that enfolds our senses at the forward edge of time. We are pushed against the world with a quickening force that requires us to sense with, through, of, in, and across distant spaces. The result is a kinetic horizon that wakes outward around our periphery as each shot builds on the next, finally returning us to where we began. We have raced entirely around the globe, arriving back at the western edge of the American continent. Sensate's opening credits therefore position us on the edge, at the limit of a nation and at the borders of identity, genre, and televisual form. Each of the Sensate characters is initially situated at the perimeter of a sensing networked form, the cluster, that will collapse inward at an increasing rate of speed. The title of the first episode, Limbic Resonance, refers to the speculative limbic system, limbus meaning edge, that will activate to give the sensates this enhanced awareness. Race and gender geographies will fold together as their prior worlds compress into an event horizon, pulling them and us into the centripetal complexity of new and inescapable sensations. The title sequence aesthetically prepares us for the feeling of Sensate's narrative cluster geometry. Space and time will contract rapidly as the Sensate's enhanced sensories gather into a collective point of immediacy. In the case of the show's characterization, that point is its central transgender figure, Nomi Marks. The opening credits both begin and end in San Francisco, an overtly queer and trans space where Nomi is physically located. Nomi thus occupies the nucleus of the Sensate cluster as a point of attachment for the growth of its matrix, which extends out in multiple facets as the Sensates in her cluster are born. In ancient Greek, the name Nomi is phonologically equivalent to nome, meaning to know. The name indicates, quote, a means of knowing, a mark, and an organ by which one knows, the mind. The name Nomi can be translated as, quote, one who is marked by knowledge by possessing an organ of special insight. For Nomi, this organ is her sensate awareness, which is represented as a feeling that something is there that others cannot perceive. Nomi's central presence in the series is an initiatory lesson for how sensate will require both its characters and audiences to sense differently. The sensates are marked by a trans awareness that will move them into a pluralization of self, forcing them to abandon the feeling of autonomous personhood. In becoming sensate, Nomi and her cluster will become a we, in other words, a no-me. A sensate is therefore one who knows they are not one. Transgender therefore operates as a central language for how sensate shifts our sensory attentions. For example, the early mirror scene between Riley and Will overtly cites the iconography of 20th century transsexual literature as an aesthetic threshold beyond which the series will speculate. We could therefore view sensate as an implicit response to Sandy Stone's original call for trans forms that might, through a deliberate invocation of dissonance, fragment gender into new and unexpected geometries. The series posits the feel of transition, in which the variously gendered iterations of the self are consistently and constantly renegotiated as an affective vocabulary for how we might inhabit its cluster. By exploring how affects might travel horizontally within and through the collective psyche of its cluster, sensate deploys trans to interrupt our conceptions of how a narrative or self might take place, stretching our senses toward new formations. By industry standards, sensate is simply the most recent in the Wachowskis' long history of aesthetically daring and challenging to market works. Yet what makes the show so compelling is its immersive, hopeful immediacy. Sensate's speculative stretch is ultimately an inner one. Rather than pushing its vision into a distant future, the series turns inward, asking how we might arrive at our senses and thus the lives of others differently. To sense beyond the limits of the given world, we must learn to feel how we already exceed its edges, how we are already in descent. The options have already arrived, if we could find the faith to perceive them. In all its incompleteness, sensate's utopianism is nonetheless the speculative sensation that things could already be moving toward that lush, subjunctive field it asks us to touch within ourselves. Perhaps more than any other cinematic text, sensate captures the event of trans, the sensation of trans as a happening, already in motion, sensing toward unrealized contacts. To feel beyond the prison house of the then and there and the here and now is not to turn towards some far off place, it says, but to occupy our present so fully together that we burst the present world's seams. Like the Wachowskis' first work Bound, 20 years before it, sensate reminds us of the horizon, the leap, the stretch, the reach, the desiring tense already incipient between us. Thanks.